Hello and welcome to the This Works For Me Virtual Summit. I'm your host, Fernfaith Watson, and I am the Director of the Faculty Development Center at Murray State University. I am so excited about today's interview. If you are a writer or if you help people to write well, then you want to stay tuned to this episode because our guest today, Dr. Vanessa Denin, will be helping you with strategy to do exactly that. Dr. Denin, thank you so much for taking the time to share with us today.
Oh, well, thank you for having me. This is a topic that I very much enjoy talking with people about.
Great. I can't tell you how excited I am about this particular interview. And so I'm going to open the floor to you for a moment to just tell us about yourself, who you are, where you're from, and what you do.
Okay, well, I am a professor of instructional systems and learning technologies at Florida State University. I have been on the faculty here for about 15 years now, and I'm currently serving as our program coordinator. And that is just one of the hats that I wear. I also serve as co-editor-in-chief of a journal, The Internet and Higher Education, which is exactly what it sounds like, about the intersection of the internet and higher education. Mm-hmm. And I also serve as an associate editor for another journal, Educational Researcher. And that takes up a lot of my time, but when I'm not doing that, I'm busy trying to do my own research and publish it. My research focuses on how people engage in community and network activities surrounding knowledge in mediated environments. So I do a lot of online and social media research. Mm-hmm. And then I try to have a life too. Mm-hmm. It's a lot.
I can imagine. And that's why I'm just so grateful that you were able to take the time to share with us today. Among all the things that you have to do. So the title of your strategy is Using Peer Review to Become a Better Author. For those of us who do not understand the concept of peer review, could you just tell us quickly what that is?
Absolutely. I know that when people say, ooh, peer review, it can sound a little mysterious if you're not familiar with it, but it really is quite literally what it sounds like. It is peers engaging in the process of reviewing each other's work. So for a conference, that would be reviewing conference proposals and papers, and for a journal, that would be reviewing manuscripts that have been submitted for publication. Mm-hmm. It's really not that different from a peer review that you might do in a classroom or a peer review that you might do with a couple of colleagues where you just ask somebody to read your paper and give you some feedback on it. The difference is that it's done in a more formal structure here with somebody in the middle of it all, either a conference planner or an editor who manages sending the documents back and forth among people, which helps mask identity. So you don't know who is going to read your paper and give you peer feedback when you send something in as an author, or when you're a peer reviewer, you don't know, for most journals, you don't know who's manuscript you're reading and giving feedback on. And that's just something that helps the process along. But it's really that simple.
Okay. Thanks for clarifying that. So could you help us understand, you know, why you started to use peer review to help you to become a better author? And how has that strategy worked for you?
Well, peer review can be a rather natural process of an academic career. It's something that most people just fall into doing because they recognize that it's expected of them, or they have a colleague who is organizing a conference or who works on an editorial staff of a journal and asks them to get involved. But taking it to the next level and using it to help improve your own work as an author is something that I just stumbled upon. When I started doing peer reviews, I just did it because it was the kind of thing that felt right, that I should be doing peer review because other people were peer reviewing my work. Mm-hmm. As I started doing peer reviews, I realized that I was getting a lot of ideas, both good ideas and bad ideas, from the things that I was reviewing. it started with conferences, and I was learning, like, whoa, this is a really good proposal. Oh, I see what they did there to explain their work to me mm-hmm. really clearly. Or, ooh, this proposal, I don't understand it. Or, this is really confusing. They didn't explain this well enough. Mm-hmm. So I started to recognize that there were a lot of lessons to be learned. Mm-hmm. I thought, well, now I need to capture some of this. I need to remember this. I need to not just review this proposal or review this manuscript and walk away saying, oh, there's another service task done. I'll just check that off and put it on my annual report. But instead to take a moment and say, what did I learn from doing this review? Mm-hmm. What did this author do well or not do well? And how can I either incorporate this or avoid this the next time I submit my own manuscript? In fact, I've gotten to the point now, many years into my career, having done a lot of reviews and having done a lot of reflecting on the reviews that I've done, to where I feel like I can send my work out as an author and anticipate 3/4 of the feedback that I'm going to get wow. from the peer reviewers, because I've learned to think both like an author and a peer reviewer and like an editor now too. So that's an extra level of it, is I see a lot of other people's peer reviews as an editor navigating that process.
Well, I really like that, how you transition from the point where, okay, I'll do this because, you know, it's just the right thing to do. I'm sending papers out, but so why not help the field by doing it? But you transition from just doing it as, you know, an obligatory thing to actually the place where you're reflecting on what you're doing, and it's actually helped you to become an expert in this. So I really like that. So what are the top things you have learned about being a good peer reviewer and author in this whole process?
I would say that I've learned a lot about what work in progress looks like, mm-hmm. the wide range of work in progress. It's helped me better gauge what a manuscript looks like when it's ready to be sent out for review. I think some people hold on to their manuscripts too long and don't send them out because they're trying to achieve some sort of perfection, mm-hmm. or because they know that some part of it's not working quite right, but they're afraid to send it out. It also might be an opportunity then to ask a local peer to read it and to say, this part isn't working, I need peer review. But I've learned to identify where peer review is needed. Mm-hmm. I've also learned when it's way too early in a manuscript to send it out, where either an editor needs to say, no, I can't send this to reviewers. It doesn't have all the parts in place. It's not formatted well enough. It just doesn't seem right. Or where the reviewers will just say, no, this is so far from being ready that we're not even going to be giving useful feedback on it. Mm-hmm. So knowing that is important. I've learned a lot about shifting my perspective back and forth. When we work as authors, we're focused on one thing, aren't we? I want to be published. And I want to be published quickly, and I want to be published with minimal revisions, and I want to feel good about my work. I want to feel that other people like my work. When you are functioning as a reviewer, sometimes people perceive that as it's a little bit of a test of themselves. You know, like, can I figure out what all the flaws are with this manuscript? Sometimes people are doing the task really quickly. You'll spend all the time in the world on your own manuscript. How much time will you give to somebody else's manuscript? It may not be that much time. And so you focus on just putting in the important parts. But when you're a reviewer, you need to think of it the same way you do when you think of providing feedback to your students, and you want your students to be able to accept your feedback. Mm-hmm. Students don't react well when all you do is tell them everything they did wrong. Mm-hmm. You need to tell them what they did right. And if all you do is tell them what they did wrong and give them no ideas for fixing it, they walk away feeling demoralized. Mm-hmm. Authors are a lot like students. When you're an author, if you receive a review that just tells you everything you did wrong, mm-hmm. but doesn't give you some ideas on how to fix it, you may not know how to fix it. And if nobody tells you what you did right, you might walk away feeling really dejected about what you've done, and then unable to really connect with the feedback. And I hear a lot of authors, you know, say, oh, well, reviewer two is just stupid. And then they don't connect with reviewer two's feedback. Reviewer two's feedback may actually be some really valuable feedback. Mm-hmm. Another thing that I've learned about reviewers' feedback is that peer reviewers can't always tell you exactly what needs to be done to fix your manuscript. Sometimes they give you feedback and even suggest that you do something that doesn't make sense in the context of your manuscript. Mm-hmm. As an author, what you need to do is to look beyond that and say, the reviewer has identified a part of my manuscript that's not working. They've given a suggestion that doesn't work for me, but I still need to do something with this part of this manuscript. I need to spend some time thinking about why somebody read this and had this perception of it and how I can change that.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So spending some time with those reviews and not feeling negative about them as an author, and recognizing that even if you get those reviews that sound really negative, that you just hit somebody on a bad day, or they were rushing through the task and not being really careful with their language, or they felt like it was a test of their own ability and forgot to tell you everything that they did right. Keeping that perspective in place as an author can help you not feel quite as emotional about the critical feedback. And then you can really use that feedback to make your article better. I've come to think that although we use this masked review process where the reviewers and the authors don't directly connect with each other and they don't see each other, we need to think of each other as a collaboration. We need to think of each other as a team. When I peer review, I think about how can I help this author's paper get better? Even if I don't think that what they have done is going to make it for publication at this point, I may think about how can I help them do their next study better? And how can I give the editor good information to help them make their editorial decision? I'm part of the team. If we all think about it that way, we'll get a lot further in the world of publishing and we'll have better manuscripts out there. Everybody wins from that when that's what happens.
Wow, you said you gave us so many good advice there. I mean, I like the point that you made about really catching people doing something right, because I know when we're giving feedback, as you said, when we are performing those roles, it seems as if we're under pressure to at least find a couple of things that are not good about the paper. And so if we're not careful, we just provide the feedback without giving any, you know, encouraging or constructive criticism. And I also like the point where you are basically saying to people who receive the feedback, don't take it too personal. Because when you do that, you run the risk of really not getting the spirit of the feedback and making the constructive review. So thanks for sharing all of that. So if one would like to, how do you get involved in peer review? Or if other people would like to get involved in it, how do you typically get involved in peer review?
There are a lot of ways to get involved in peer reviewing. It doesn't always seem obvious because it doesn't always just jump out at you. But ways to get involved if you don't currently peer review anywhere would be conferences are a great place to start. Often when you submit to a conference, there's a checkbox somewhere in there that asks if you would be willing to do peer reviews for the conference. Start checking yes on that box. I've had people say to me before, well, I don't check yes because why would they want me? I'm just a lowly graduate student. Mm-hmm. You don't know. They might ask you to review. Some conferences incorporate graduate students in their review process regularly. Some conferences have a second process where they have graduate students doing reviews in parallel to people who have already earned their degrees. So that is another possibility that can happen. Some journals have signups on their website. You have to dig, you have to look a little bit and find the contacts or see if there's a form on there for people who are interested in reviewing. If you do that, you can get your name put in the database of potential reviewers. The more information you fill out on these forms about what your areas of expertise are, the more likely you are to get asked to review. If you are at a conference or in another venue where you happen to meet somebody who works on an editorial staff, whether as an editor-in-chief or as an associate or an assistant editor, if that's a journal that you're interested in, give them your business card and tell them that you would be interested in reviewing for them. Start up the conversation. We always need good peer reviewers. So they'll probably happily go home with your business card, and as soon as they have a suitable piece for you to review, ask you to be the reviewer for that piece. People also just get asked to review after they've published a bit. I get asked to review for journals that are in other fields that I don't immediately recognize, because I do a lot of interdisciplinary work and I've just been identified as somebody who does research in that area. So that's what happens after you've been in the career for a while and you've been publishing, is people are looking for a reviewer who can comment on the use of social networks to support informal learning, and then the editor will find you and ask you to review. But take all of the opportunities that you can find locally, and they'll be there. If you are a graduate student or a recent graduate, ask your advisor, ask your major professor to help you get involved in reviewing, because they can recommend the appropriate venues in your field. They can connect you to the people who need other people to do reviews, mm-hmm. and they may be able to engage in a shadow review process with you if that is appropriate.
Yeah. Wow, thanks for sharing that. So about, you know, how much reviewing should someone do and in what venue?
Oh, that is a good question. And I hear people saying that they don't want to do reviews sometimes because it takes up their time. It takes away from their ability to work on their own manuscripts or other things that they have to do, and that it feels like largely uncompensated work that doesn't count for a lot. But let me put this to you in a different way. Each time you send one of your own manuscripts out for review, you have just created labor for other people. You have created that same kind of work for probably two or three other people. And that's for each round of review that you've created that labor again. Wow. If we all are sending our pieces out to journals and saying, no, I can't review, then who is going to do all of these reviews? We're creating a lot of work for people who we don't even know who they are, because we're not going to do it. Mm-hmm. So how much reviewing should you do and in what venues? I think everybody is under obligation to do the same number of reviews or more that they are requesting of others. I feel like as a senior person in the field right now, it's actually my obligation to do a few more reviews than I am requesting of others, because I know that I have doctoral students who are sending out manuscripts who are less likely to be requested as reviewers right now.
Wow.
And they are creating labor. So it's about finding the balance of labor. And I do... So I'm an editor. I'm doing a lot as an editor. But just to give you an example, I'm pulling together my annual evaluation materials right now. And I believe I did 16 peer reviews for other journals last year. I have three that I'm working on right now. It's as I start off a new year. Now that's just for journals. Mm-hmm. I reviewed for three conferences last year. And across those three conferences, I reviewed 17 different proposals and or papers. In some cases, they were actually full papers that were proposed to the conferences.
You know what I'm thinking when I hear you say all of that? And it really ties in line with the title of your strategy. Because if you should look at this metaphor, I've never seen a pipe running water and that pipe is not wet. That pipe is going to get wet just by having the water pass through it. It's the same thing you're doing. So when you're telling me about all of these things that you're doing, reviewing 16 journal articles and all of these presentations, I'm sure, as you said before, that you really have gained insight from reading those things, which really helps you to become a better writer yourself. Wow.
Oh, absolutely. And when you start to see the things that other people do, and you're looking at their manuscript in that way, which, by the way, I think is a very different way than we look at published manuscripts when we're trying to read them to support our own research and to do literature reviews. Mm-hmm. So when you're looking as a peer reviewer, you're not just looking at the content, you're looking at the form, you're looking at the method, you know, you're asking yourself questions about whether or not this is publication worthy, whereas the published things that we see are already quite polished and have been deemed publication worthy by somebody. You can see what really works for an author or what really doesn't work for an author. Mm-hmm. It's something else I haven't mentioned about this yet, but I do want to be sure to mention that's a big benefit of peer reviewing, mm-hmm. is most journals, this doesn't tend to happen with conferences, but most journals, after the review process has been conducted, mm-hmm. will send an email back to all of the reviewers thanking them for their review and letting them know the disposition, so the decision that was made on that manuscript. Along with that typically comes the collection of reviews. Now, sometimes I get those, and it has been, 2 months since I reviewed that manuscript, but, it takes time for the other reviews to come in and for the editor to make a decision. And I look at it, and I think to myself, can I identify which of those was my review at mm-hmm. this point in time? And how did my review stack up against the other reviews? Mm-hmm. Do we agree mm-hmm. or not? What things did other people see in this paper that I missed? And there's a lot to be learned. Exactly. That and getting those perspectives. And that's something that you just don't see when you sit back and read the published literature.
Yeah, that's the same thing I was thinking recently when I received feedback the summer that you're talking about, and I looked at my review versus what the other reviewers recommended, and I was able to see, okay, wow. I was pleased to see that a lot of what I said, they agreed with it, but I also got insights from what they recommended. So you have a good point there. Yeah.
And everybody has a different perspective mm-hmm. on an article that they read. You'll have some agreement and you'll have some disagreement. You'll also have reviewers who were asked to review because they are experts in the subject matter area, and you'll have reviewers who are asked to review because they are experts on the methods that were used, and they're all going to hone in on different parts of the article.
Wow, that's good to remind us about. That's a very good knowledge to have.
Even now, I review things all the time where I'm willing to and comfortable with saying, mm-hmm. I'm not an expert on whatever method they use here. I'm not an expert on this. I'm not going to comment on this part of it. I'm an expert on the topic mm-hmm. that was done here. Or I'm reviewing something that is out of my field, out of my discipline, but I'm an expert on some part of it. And so I will write comments in the review that say, I'm not from this discipline, mm-hmm. And I don't know if this is the norm for your discipline. This is the norm for my discipline.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, in as much as it is useful to you. But that also exposes you to, what happens in some other fields. Yes. It might expose you to some methods that you wouldn't naturally gravitate toward yourself. There's so much to be learned. It's really, really a wonderful thing.
I have to say that what you just said is very comforting. It's comforting to know, because someone perhaps couldn't imagine that they could do something like that. Like, really? You mean you're supposed to review this article, but you can literally say, I am not, strong in this area? That's encouraging for people who are thinking that they could try this as a strategy, to know that you don't have to know everything about reviewing.
Well, you don't. And if we go back to the word peer, mm-hmm. what is a peer? And how broadly are we going to define that term in academe? I hear people say all the time that, a peer reviewer, surely that's just the senior scholars. The senior scholars are the best peer reviewers or the correct peer reviewers. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they're the people who take the least amount of time and care with their review. I often find the junior scholars write really wonderful, detailed reviews and give some helpful feedback to authors. And I appreciate that. Mm-hmm. If we try to define our peer group as experts or, people just like me, I don't know how many people just like me with the exact knowledge and skills that I have are out there available to review my manuscripts. And I don't want my manuscripts to be read by the 20 researchers out there in the world who are just like me. So let's broaden our definition of peer. Maybe I want to consider my peer to be anybody who is functioning as a researcher in the field of instructional systems and learning technologies. If I want my work to have that kind of reach, then those are my peers. If I expect that graduate students who have, you know, there is a bottom level threshold, like graduate students who have had their courses on research methods, who have, you know, a couple years into their studies, they should be able to read my articles and understand them and make a judgment about whether or not it's good. So yes, those are peers too. And not everybody's an expert on everything. We need to defer to each other and we need to share our perspectives.
Right. Yeah, thanks for reminding us, because a lot of times when we look at the word peer review, we just focus on the review. We don't even see the peer part.
Yeah.
So thanks for magnifying that part of it, because that's important. So are there any challenges that are associated with this?
I think that the biggest challenges are sometimes it feels a little awkward to do a peer review. Sometimes it feels like a test of yourself. Mm-hmm. And a bit of what we were just talking about, mm-hmm. you might start reading a manuscript and get partway into it. I have no idea like what this is. And even if you don't feel confident putting in the review that you don't know what this is to tell the author, it's fine. There's usually a place to put, give a separate comment to the editor. Mm-hmm. And you could say to the editor, this is not my area of strength. Mm-hmm. So please, I defer. A good way of putting it is, I defer to other reviewers,
right,
as to whether or not this topic was addressed sufficiently, or as to whether or not this was the most appropriate method to use with this data set, whatever that may be. One of the other challenges is always going to be time. Mm-hmm. And we feel pressed for time. Our institutions often don't count peer review for very much. As I mentioned earlier, I'm counting it all up right now to put it into an annual review report. Mm-hmm. But nobody's really going to sit there and say, wow, you did how many reviews last year? A plus for you. It just shows that I'm engaged in the field. Mm-hmm. But I would like to think that we need to be thinking not only of ourselves, but the strength yeah. of our profession yeah. as a whole. And mm-hmm. so we need to push past this idea that it's not worth very much and change our mindsets. And we have to work to change other people's mindsets. And we may need to work to change the mindsets in our universities. So this is a really big picture challenge I'm talking about here. People will say things to you sometimes, you particularly junior faculty who are tenure earning, don't do so many peer reviews. Mm-hmm. You need to be focused on publishing.
Yeah.
And while, I mean, that's true, please don't do 50 peer reviews in a year. Don't spend all of your time doing peer reviews rather than publishing. But don't say no to every peer review just because you need to focus on publishing. Find a way to fit that into your schedule and to reflect on it at the end and to learn from every peer review that you have done. And you can learn in the most surprising of ways too.
Exactly.
It's something I'm realizing now, something else I forgot to mention, but it's a great way to learn, or a great thing to learn, mm-hmm. is that during the peer review process, if you submit a manuscript, mm-hmm. The editor sends it out, gets the reviews get sent back to you. You then, if the editor has decided that you get a revise and resubmit, mm-hmm. then you have the opportunity to respond to those reviews and improve your manuscript. When you send it back, you don't just send in the improved manuscript, but you also send in a document where you respond to the reviewers. As a peer reviewer, you get to see what other people send in those documents. Those documents, those responses to reviewers, are like a mystery for a lot of people. How do I do it? What should it look like? I've not seen that before. Mm-hmm. Well, there's a lot of variance in how those are done, but you get to see them as a peer reviewer, as other authors respond to your review, and you will learn effective ways of addressing that feedback. Mm-hmm. So being privy to that process of a mm-hmm. manuscript as it goes through the cycle of being work in progress to a publishable manuscript will teach you so much yes. about how to handle the reviews and respond to them in your own manuscript.
Right, very good. So on one hand, especially for a new faculty who have a lot on their plate, they should be careful in terms of how many reviews they do, but at the same time, they really shouldn't run from it because it has potential benefits like some of what you have been talking about.
Mm-hmm. Right, and the benchmark that I gave you to try to aspire to apply the field with as many reviews as you are requesting, mm-hmm. I think is a pretty manageable one for most people. And then for senior people to try to do a little bit more, knowing that you have graduate students and junior scholars who are sending things out and who aren't getting asked, they're just not being asked to peer review yet, mm-hmm. So you can help to pick up some of the slack. The other thing is, as a senior reviewer, I remember the first few reviews that I did, mm-hmm. and it took me a long time to do it. Yeah. I can't even tell you how many I've done now, plus how much I see as an editor. I can review really quickly now. Mm-hmm. It's a skill. Senior people can do their reviews a lot more quickly. There's no reason why we can't do a few more reviews to serve the field.
Yeah. Wow. So are there any resources that you think would be good for our viewers to review?
Yes. I mean, in some ways, the best resources are the artifacts of the peer reviews themselves, and that's something that we can't share widely. That's just something you get to see if you're doing reviews. Mm-hmm. But I would definitely recommend to anybody, particularly a graduate student who's working with an advisor, to see if they could shadow review and get an opportunity to see what their professors are doing in the course of reviews. Professors can make a request to a journal or to a conference to make sure it's okay to have a graduate student as that kind of reviewer. Mm-hmm. But there are other resources that are out there. In fact, I'm going to pull some of them together for you, and I will post them on my blog, and you can share it as a link with all of this. I have a blog on my website, which is it's pretty simple. It's my name, VanessaDennin.com. Mm-hmm. And what I will put up there for you are some links to publishing companies. The publishers actually produce a fair number of educational resources for authors, for peer reviewers, and for editors. A lot of people don't know about these because we go straight to a journal's website and just dive in and say, where's that submission link? I want to send in my paper, or how do I log in to do this review? And they're not looking around to say, you know, what does this publishing company have to offer to help prepare me to be a better author or a better reviewer? But I'll share links to some of those. There have also been some papers that have been published explicitly on the process, a few on how to be a good peer reviewer, as well as a few about what happens in peer review processes and thinking broadly about what our obligation is to the field, whether or not it's a process that works well or is broken, and what we should aspire to do. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people don't see those because, well, how many of us do research on peer review? Mm-hmm. Not very many people, so not very many people are looking for those articles or citing those articles. Mm-hmm. They become very useful when you are teaching graduate students or mentoring graduate students, and that's why I have some of those resources. So I'll pull some of those together as a bibliography and make the appropriate links, and that's something that you can include for anybody who's viewing this so they can check out some of those resources.
Great. I'm going to check them out myself. And viewers, I would encourage you to do the same. So within the last minute or so, is there anything that you'd like to share with our viewers, be it an encouragement or a final challenge or anything that you'd like to share in this moment?
I have an encouragement and I have a challenge. And I think you know what my challenge is going to be now, don't you? You know, my challenge is going to be for the next year, try to do enough reviews to make up for the labor that you're asking of other reviewers. So that's 2 to 3 reviews for everything that you send out to be reviewed by others for each time that you're sending it out, each revision of it. The encouragement that I would like to leave you with is that this is all very manageable. The publication process is here and is done the way that it is done, not to discourage people, even though it can feel that way at times, not really to serve as gatekeepers, but instead, let me encourage you to think about it as a learning process through which we all become stronger researchers and stronger authors. Mm-hmm. Let me encourage you, no matter how the feedback that you receive is worded and how much it may sting initially to get a rejection, to pause, think about how that actually was somebody else's labor and that they were trying to offer up some ideas about what's not working and or what will make this better, and read their feedback in that spirit. Think about what you can learn from it and how you can make something better. Learning is not all about happiness. Learning is uncomfortable sometimes. Learning happens through failure. Make that failure productive failure, where you take the feedback and run with it. And by the way, contrary to popular belief, senior scholars don't get their manuscripts accepted the first time they go through review. And senior scholars get their manuscripts rejected all the time.
Wow.
They just don't let it stop them. They take that feedback, they revise that manuscript, and they send it back out into review.
Wow.
That's how they're successful.
Wow, thank you so much. I am encouraged and I am challenged. Seriously, thank you very much for taking the time to share with us today. And to our viewers, I just want to thank you for taking the time to listen to this conversation. I would encourage you to share it with others. And I really hope that you will join us in the next episode of this Works For Me Virtual Summit. See you soon.